Holy Father, When the day of Pentecost fully comes, they will all be one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues as of fire, and one set upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak with other tongues, as the Spirit gave utterance. And there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when this sound occurred, the multitude came together and were confused, because everyone heard them speak in his own language. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying to one another, "Behold, are not all these who speak Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each in our own language in which we were born, Parthians and Medes and Elamites, those dwelling in Mesopotamia and in Judea and Cappadocia and Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, in Egypt and in the parts of Libya adjoining Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretes and Arabs? We hear them speaking in our own tongues the wonderful words of
some of them wanted him arrest him, but no one laid hands on him. The officers then went back to the chief priests and Pharisees, who said to them, "Why did you not bring him?" The officers answered, "No man ever spoke like this man." The Pharisees answered them, "Are you led astray, you also? Have any of the authorities of the Pharisees believed in him, but this crowd, who do not know the law, are accursed?" Nicodemus, who had gone to him before, and who was one of them, said to them, "Does our law judge a man without first giving him a hearing and learning what he does?" They replied, "Are you from Galilee too? Search, and you will see that no prophet is to rise from Galilee." Again, Jesus spoke to them, saying, "I am the light of the world. He who follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life."
Glory to thee, O Lord. Glory to thee.
Christ is in the midst.
Israel shall be.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. When I was a young man, 18, 20 years old, somewhere in there, I had this idea in my head that if I could out-argue someone, they would have to believe what I said, and they would have to agree with me, because I had made the better argument, I had made the better case. And so as an 18 or 20 year old, I spent a lot of time arguing with other people. Now happily, for me anyway, most of this happened before the internet was really as big as it is now. In fact, when I went to college, I was required during my orientation to take a class on the internet and how we could use it. Social media certainly was not a thing. And so most of this rhetorical pugilism happened in person, between me and other people. And I went on like that for a few years until I had an experience in which it hit me like a train at full speed that just because you are more successful at arguing or the truth is on your side, people won't necessarily believe you or listen to you. You won't necessarily change their mind just because you're better at arguing than they are. Even if the facts support what you have to say, people may simply refuse to give you a hearing or refuse to change their mind because they don't want to. That was a real low point in my young life, but a really necessary learning moment when I realized something more than just true facts, as they say these days, was necessary to change the mind, or the heart, the perspective, the direction of another person's life, or even, and more importantly, of my own. What we see in the gospel today, we hear in the epistle, about the Holy Spirit coming as a mighty rushing wind. And they're all gathered there. And they all begin to speak of the good things of God. They begin to proclaim the goodness of God, the true things about God. And the people that hear this rushing wind and come together, they hear it proclaimed in their own language. Several things here all at once that identify the character of the Holy Spirit in this is one is that it brings people together. When the Spirit rushes upon the disciples, people come running together. also out of the many tongues, out of the many different languages, each hears the same good news of God in their own from these uneducated, unlettered hillbillies. So out of the many languages, one language is heard. So this work of the Spirit draws into unity. It brings people together. And what does it bring them together for? What purpose is it given for? So that they might hear, proclaim to them the good things of God, of God's victory over the hostile powers, over his offering of mercy and forgiveness, the absolution of sins, a place for them in his household, in his kingdom, the offer of life everlasting. And we heard that in the gospel as well, that the Spirit is given so that you might have a river of life welling up within you. So the Spirit draws everyone together in order that they might hear proclaimed to them the saving acts of God. Not only what he has done, but what he is offering to do for each and every person who hears. And in that, the inner character of that outer proclamation that goes from one mouth to one ear, the inner character, the quality, the experience of that proclamation when it's received is like a little spring bubbling up inside. The joy of good news that comes unexpected, unbidden, but warmly received. This is the character of the Holy Spirit's action, his work, is that it draws us together. It speaks to us of the good things of God, of his salvation, his saving work, his mercy, his forgiveness. Inviting us into that. And as a testimony of the truth of that invitation, a river of life bubbling up inside, full of the joy of the Spirit, the love of God, as an inner witness, a testimony to this truth, this offer, this invitation. And so much of that was missing in all my attempts to argue people into what I believed to be true, into what I believed to be correct. I might have had the right ideas, but I wasn't searching for unity so much as I was looking to impose my perspective on someone else. If you would just do it my way, things would be better, and you would be doing what is right and correct and true. But the Spirit draws to unity, draws to oneness, brings people together in order to proclaim the goodness of God, in order to give life. And so there is in this, for me, and perhaps also for you, a good guide to how we ought to speak and interact with each other and with those outside of the church. That it isn't worthwhile simply to argue and to say you're wrong and this is why you're wrong and I'm right. But rather, if our speech, if our conduct is shaped by what we are learning here on Pentecost, what we seek is to draw people into looking for is concord, one accord, so that we might speak of the good things that God has done, so that we might tell of his mercy to us. We might recall for the benefit of someone else his forgiveness of our sins, his compassion toward our shortcomings, our weaknesses, the way he has healed and overcome the mistakes in our life. And so that in the speaking and in the hearing of this good news of what God has done, our interlocutor might find beginning to bubble up in them a little bit of the joy of the Spirit that calls them to himself and into the unity of the triune God whom we ourselves are living in and whom we share in and participate in the holy mysteries of the Church. So there is here for us an instruction in how we ought to speak and how we ought to conduct ourselves if we are going to be guided by history, the story of Pentecost, and if we want what we say to be fruitful, to be life-giving, and not simply correct in a way that is dry, arid, stale, and actually saps life away. The Spirit has come to give us life, to draw us into unity together. And in this day and age, when so much around us is being pulled apart, when people are constantly at odds, constantly fighting, disagreeing, arguing, the unity that we are supposed to have, to which we have been called in Christ, is so vitally important as a witness to the world that what we say about God is true, and that in him we are united in a bond of love and fidelity that is stronger than the passions of the flesh, the passing perspectives of our time, our day, our age, our culture, and that in that unity we are bound together in a love that is stronger than death, and that we conduct ourselves in a way that invites others into that. Let your speech be seasoned with grace. Let your conduct be full of the wisdom, the love, and the life Holy Spirit, to whom belongs all glory, honor, and worship of the Father and the Son, now and ever, through the ages of ages.
Thank you.
especially the newly departed servants of God, the Metropolitan Hilary and Michael, and for all our fathers and brethren of the Orthodox departed this life before us, who here and on the world lie sleeping in the pool.
Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
Again, we pray for mercy, life, peace, health, salvation, visitation, for the servants of God, the newborn child of God, Alexandra, Ava, Nina, and the children to be born of them, Bill, and all those who are traveling, all those suffering from violence and abandonment in Afghanistan and Ukraine, the sick and suffering servants of God throughout the world, especially the infant Julie, Samuel, Kenneth, Randy, Adam, James, Alina, John, Victor, Bonnie, Judy, Karen, Paul, Anastasia, Matthew, Nadesha, Jane, James, Roger, Peter, Arlene, Austin, Vivian, Alexander, Walt, Jessica, Karen, Darby, David, Kathy, John, Eugenia, and Helen, the victims of war, civil war, violence, abuse, neglect, abortion, and natural disasters, the homeless, the helpless, the hopeless, especially the children, the captives, Micah, Holly, and Mary, the brethren of this holy temple, and for the pardon and remission of their sins.
Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
Again, we ask thy great mercy on our brothers and sisters who are presently involved in war. Remove from their midst all hostility, confusion, and hatred. Lead everyone along the path of reconciliation and peace, we pray thee. Hear us and have mercy on us.
Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
Again, we pray for those who bear fruit and do good works in this holy and all venerable temple, for those who labor, those who sing, and for all the people here present who await thy grace and his mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
Unite them to thy holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, and number them with thy chosen Father, that with us they may glorify the honorable and majestic name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, now and ever and ever.
Lord, have
Post Reverend Archbishop Alexander, Archbishop of Dallas and the South, may the Lord God remember his kingdom always, now and ever into ages of ages.
The entire Episcopal Orthodox Church in America, the priests, the deacons, and the monastics, may the Lord God remember in his heavenly kingdom always, now and ever, and unto ages of ages. You and all Orthodox Christians, may the Lord God remember in his heavenly kingdom always, now and ever, and unto ages of ages.
where the manifestos were unseen. And we thank thee for this liturgy which thou hast made to accept our heavens, who have stand by the thousands of archangels and hosts of angels, the cherubim and the seraphim, six winged, many eyed, who soar aloft, borne on their wings. Sing the triumphant hymn, shouting, proclaiming, and singing.
Thank you. Let us see.
In the fear of God, with faith and love, draw near.
Thank you.
Serve God back on the occasion of his name, and preserve
blessing. And this is good for Orthodox and non-Orthodox travelers. None of you wants the devil to go with you. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus Christ, our God, the true and living way, who journeyed with your earthly Father Joseph and your most pure Virgin Mother and the angels, and accompanied moving with all those who amaze, we humbly entreat you, O most holy Master. Accompany these, your servants, with your grace, and as you did for Tobias, send an angel as guide and guardian, protecting and delivering them from every evil circumstance, resulting from enemies visible and invisible. Direct them to the fulfillment of your commandments, send them to pray peacefully, profitably, and soundly, and bring them back safely again. Grant that they may fulfill their good purposes to your good pleasure and favorably to your glory. For yours it is to be merciful and to save us, and unto you we send up glory, together with your Father, who is without beginning, and your all holy, good, and life-giving Spirit, now and ever and unto the ages of ages. Raise your hand right in the middle of the image.